Welcome to all the participants for the webinar on green buildings by VSKV Harish sir from the Department of Electrical Engineering, School of Technology, Pandit Deen Dayal Petroleum University. I would like to thank the IEEE Hyderabad section, the HODs, principals, management of Shreyas Institute of Technology, and our student branch counselor KMVP Prasad sir for giving this opportunity to organize these webinars in this pandemic time. Harish sir, over to you.
Thank you. Very good morning to all the viewers. Thank you for the kind introduction, my Swaroop. I hope all of you are safe and sound at this time of pandemic. So without wasting further ado, we will move forward. I will be, for the next 1 hour, I'll be focusing on green building. Of us are working from homes and getting our jobs and duties performed, I believe that it is high time that we start to think of smart homes with due regards to the smart villages and smart cities concept. With this thought, let us move forward. I shall be focusing on how the buildings as an entity be regarded as a responsive entity to regulate power in an electrical power system. We shall look into the energy usage trends for building sector, buildings as an energy sector, from the reports published by several agencies like United States, United States Ministry of Power, Bureau of Energy Efficiency, TERI, MNRE, so on and so forth. What you are seeing on screen, the plot shows the changes in percentage in floor area, changes in percentage in population, building sector energy use, and energy related emissions globally since 2010. This is this plot I have taken from the International Energy Agency's report. International Energy Agency is a Paris-based autonomous intergovernmental organization, and I have taken this from its World Energy Statistics report. Now, from this, the statistic majorly, what it shows is that the buildings along with the construction sector accounts for nearly 40% of the total energy-related CO2 emissions and about 36% of the final energy use worldwide. That means that the buildings as a sector offers the largest cost-effective greenhouse gas mitigation potential with net cost savings and economic gains possible through the implementation of existing technologies, futuristic technologies, policies, and also the building designs. Now, what we can see from the plot is that the floor area has been increasing and the growth has been pretty extensive. Also, because of this, there has been, and with an increased population and an increased improved standard of living, there has been an increase in the energy usage as well, and hence there has been increases in emission sector as well. Now, the emissions which you are seeing in the figure are the GHG emissions, which comprise of both direct GHG emissions, greenhouse gas emissions, and indirect GHG emissions. Let me see it in through. Direct GHG emissions are emissions that are coming from the sources which are owned or controlled by the reporting entity. For example, emissions from combustion in boilers, furnaces, vehicles, or emissions from chemical production in their own process equipment. On the other hand, indirect GHG emissions can be categorized into electricity indirect emissions and other non-electricity indirect emissions. Electricity indirect emissions accounts for GHG emissions from the generation of purchased electricity consumed by the company, right? And other indirect or non-electricity GHG emissions are, for example, extraction and production from purchased materials, transportation of the purchased fuels, use of products and services, so on and so forth. Now, in 2018, the global emissions from buildings increased 2% for the second consecutive year to 9.6 gigatons of carbon dioxide. That means the change in trend is there when the emissions had been leveling off. The change in trends, as you can see, that the emissions have been leveling off here from 2013 to 2016, but there has been increase, a 2% increase in emissions from 2016 to 2018. Right? What is this growth? This growth was driven by strong floor space expansion, population expansion, right? And this led to a 1% increase in the energy consumption as well. As you can see, that there is a slight increase here. Energy consumption as well to around 125 exajoules, or to be around 35 to 36% of the global energy use. Now, the question that creeps up is, do we all have to reduce the energy consumption or energy usage? No. See, rising population, growing economy, and quest for an improved quality of life has increased the energy consumption, especially in the developing and emerging economies like India. Now, increase in energy consumption increases the human development index. And human development index is proportional to the economic growth of a country. That means there is a proportional relationship between the economic growth and the energy consumption, which of course is variable over time and location. Now, if we look into the global buildings energy sector final energy use by fuel type for the same duration of 2010 to 2018, we can see the final energy use is in exajoules. Exajoules is equal to 10 to the power of 18 joules. Now, from this figure, from this trend, what we can see is that the global growth in buildings sector final energy use has concentrated on electricity, natural gas, and traditional biomass. And higher electricity use in recent years has further increased the CO2 emissions, as we have seen in the previous slide. Now, a major source of rising energy use, as you could see, and also hence the GHG emissions by the global building stock is electricity, the use of which has increased more than 19%, more than 19% since 2010 figure, generated majorly from the coal and natural gas. This indicates why we have put this figure is this indicates how crucial it is to make clean and renewable sources of energy accessible, and also when it comes to the building, and also to use passive and low energy designs more widely in the building sector. Now, let us look what are the services, that a building asks for electricity. In this above figure, I want to say that this traditional biomass usually refers to the conventional solid biomass, example, charcoal and forest or agricultural resources used in inefficient heating and cooking equipment. Renewables include solar thermal technologies as well as modern biomass, for example, wooden pellets and biogas. And hence, the traditional biomass and renewables are shown differently here. Right? Now, from 2000, if we see here that what are the services that have been asking for more of the energy usage, electricity usage, from 2017 to 2018, the energy intensity continued to improve for space heating and lighting, but increased for space cooling and remained steady for water heating, cooking, and appliances. At an around, if we can see here, 8% increase in 2018, space cooling became the fastest growing use of energy in buildings since 2010, though it accounted for only a small portion of the total demand at 6%. That means space cooling, that means we have to look into the air conditioning aspect. Globally, greater end-use energy consumption due to significantly higher electricity use since 2010 for space cooling, appliances, and hot water is resulting in increased GHG emissions also. Although space heating, water heating, and cooking continue to the primary to be the primary energy and use demand in the buildings energy sector globally, the fastest growing end users are still space cooling, appliances, and other pluggable loads. This means the LEDs, which we are all LED lamps or LED lighting, which we are all aware of, continue to be significant in reducing the energy consumption for lighting as the floor area is increasing, as we have seen in the previous trends, and the floor area has been increasing rapidly in hot and humid conditions, hot and humid countries, hence the demand is also increasing. Now, owing to technological improvements, which we are seeing, the advertisements as well, and also the policy supports that the technologies are coming at handy, that they are, the costs are also being reducing as per the market, and Energy Efficiency in Services Limited, EESL, is also been working very extensively in getting the energy efficient products to the consumers, especially in rural areas as well. The overall reductions have been made in energy and intensity for space heating, lighting, appliances, cooking, and water heating. This means that the energy efficient green building systems and also building designs and envelopes continue to limit growth in both residential and non-residential building energy use. So what we have learned so far, first, that building sector accounts for around 36 to 40% of the total energy use and 30 to 35% of the total GHG emissions. Second, these energy use and the emissions are increasing. Third, such increases were driven by strong floor area expansion and population expansion and the improved standard of living. While the efficiency improvements are continuing, but they are not being adequate to outpace the demand growth. Fourth, out of all the services that a building can provide of, space cooling energy intensity has increased as a result of greater cooling demand in hot and humid regions. Fifth, lighting demand has increased due to increase in floor area. So the two major services would be, or the equipment or appliances that need to be worked on, are the heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system, which is HVAC, and the lighting system and pluggable. Now we will jump into the green buildings aspect. Now there are several definitions of green buildings which you will find in several books, literature, and also on the internet. But the major ones, which all the other definitions have been taken off, are given by the World Green Building Council, US Green Building Council, and the Environmental Protection Agencies of US. As you would see from these definitions, the US Green Building Council concepts on the holistic approach that a building can have with a positive or negative effect on the surrounding environment. Whereas the World Green Building Council takes into account the phase of design, construction, and operation, and the energy being used in all these three phases. Whereas the US Environmental Protection Agency increases the range and says that throughout a building's whole life cycle, from the siting up till the deconstruction or dismantlement — deconstruction is nothing but the selective dismantlement of the building components, specifically for reuse, repurposing, recycling, waste management, so on and so forth. Now, the beautiful aspect that you can look from all these definitions is, this is not something which is new. This is something which we can see from the very previous 100 years before architecture as well, that green buildings is a concept that uses Jal, Vayu, Prithvi, Akash in a very optimum way. That means during construction and operation of building, due considerations have to be given to energy use in terms of energy efficiency, water use in terms of rainwater harvesting, sewage treatment plant usage, water efficiency, where water efficiency is reducing the wastage of water by measuring the amount of water required for any particular activity and the amount of water used or delivered, water disposal, and building's effect on the site. So this is something which is not a rocket science or not a new. It is only something that we have to focus on the site, the building materials, and what the building owner wants. Now, there are certain benefits of having a green building. A green building, there are tangible benefits. It has been reported, the report suggests that around 30 to 50% of energy reduction can happen. Up to 40% of reduction can happen in fresh water demand. 40 to 65% of reduction can happen in the building water consumption, and 30 to 40% of reduction can happen in the operational cost of the buildings. Now, when we are talking so much of green buildings, there has to be a quantifiable index that would suggest a building green or not. And that's where the rating comes. A green building rating system is a tool that evaluates the performance of a building and its impact on the environment. The rating system usually comprises a predefined set of criteria relating to the design, construction, and operations of buildings. In India, there are predominantly four rating systems. One is LEED, very famous, it's worldwide being used, that is Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design. There is one rating system which is given by the India Green Building Council, IGBC. There is one rating system which is given by the Associated Chambers of Commerce and Industry of India, ASSOCHAM, which is GEM. GEMS, they give GEMS. And what you are seeing on your screen is GRIHA, the Green Rating for Integrated Habitat Assessment. In addition to these rating systems, there is also the Energy Consumption Building Code, ECBC, and the National Building Code, which provides the guidelines on energy consumption. All buildings in India need to comply with these prescribed guidelines. Now, GRIHA is very famously being used, and it was developed jointly by TERI and the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, Government of India. It's a performance-based rating system, and it is the excellent part is that it is designed for the different climatic zones, and it incorporates regional variations. Like if a building in Mizoram can be green, but the same design and same features of that building in Hyderabad would not be green, may not be green. The GRIHA rating also unifies multiple national and state level codes and norms, such as National Building Code, the ECBC, Central Pollution Control Board, Central Groundwater Board, into a simple set of criteria. That means it is taking into the design aspect, the energy efficiency aspect, the pollution aspect, and also the water usage aspect. GRIHA is also, the rating is very common sense oriented with has non-applicability clauses. It places emphasis on using the integrated design approach and implementation of cost-effective strategies. It emphasizes on strategies to identify and reduce losses in energy consumption. Not only the design part, but it also emphasizes and ensures the comfort of the occupants, comfort of the people like us living inside a building or a building room, and ensures the acoustic, which is the sound, thermal, and visual comfort inside the building, along with the indoor air quality. Right? This is a small, not a small, but a setup that how Griha was rated. What we can see from here that there were a set of buildings where energy audits were conducted by TERI, and then the reports were generated. MNRE adopted GRIHA as a national rating, and a large amount of buildings were given the ratings as per the GRIHA's tool. Now, India has been predominantly increasing in the energy usage, but has been also been increasing in the installed capacity of green energy or renewable energy systems, especially in solar and wind. However, it faces formidable challenges in meeting its energy demands. The domestic and commercial building sectors in India accounting for approximately one-third, 33% of the total electricity consumption. And it has been estimated that these sectors are likely to consume around 37 to 40% of electricity in the coming years. Right? Also, there has been a large amount of research going on how to make an energy efficient design by architectural people, the green materials by the civil people, mechanical thermal designs, thermal energy storage, phase change material by the mechanical engineering people, and of course making those buildings as smart by use of sensors, control systems by electrical and electronics people. Now it has become imperative that we design converters, controllers, which would connect a building with the electrical power grid and help the electrical power in regulation of voltage and also for active and reactive power. This is where the concept of grid interactive building energy system creeps in. Now, for a design or the aspect of a grid interactive building energy system, there are four major aspects that need to be looked upon. First one, of course, is the modeling aspect. What are the energy transfer processes that are happening? What will be the system? What will be the surrounding? What will be the mathematical equations which you would be modeling? And what will be the solution techniques which you would be adopting for solving that model? Solving a model means knowing the parameters of the model. Second is how you would model the dynamics of the electrical power grid and integration phenomena of that power grid with the building energy which you have modeled in step one. Step three is if the occupancy changes. See, whatever system you design, whatever automation system you design, it is imperative, I strongly believe, I personally believe that it is imperative that the consumer, the occupant of the building has to be given the control. For example, if I am switching on a switch, the electricity should come. One cannot stop me for using electricity. They can penalize me if I am using it inefficiently or if I am using it at a peak demand. They can increase the electricity use, but they cannot stop the consumer from using the electricity. That is where the active occupancy control comes into the picture. What neural networks, what artificial intelligence techniques will be used? Because from use of sensors, you can get the occupancy data, but you would not be willing to use the sensor again and again. You would not be relying on to the sensors again and again. And you would want to develop some learning algorithms or artificial intelligence algorithms, which would develop a system that would make our control system, the control algorithm, a self-learning aspect, taking into account what is the occupancy pattern and what is the usage. Also, it takes into account the activity part. For example, certain thermostat settings. If I am sitting in a room and my AC is here at 26 and 27 thermostat setting. If this room, if I would be working out, if I would be doing some exercise, my metabolism would differ. And these thermostat setting, I have to put in a different setting because I would be setting a lot. So what I'm trying to say here is not only the sensor network should take into consideration how much occupancy, but also the nature of activity that I am involved in, that occupancy is involved. And at last, how would we implement it? What are the matrices or indices for which we have to evaluate the step one, step two, step three? And what happens if there are fault comes? FDD is the fault detection and diagnosis. And how we can look into. See, building energy models, the step one, first thing that we all need to know that it is an interdisciplinary aspect, and the energy transfer processes, the fundamentals of building energy usage, and the equipment that we are working on has to be there. So what we have done for the last half an hour is see what buildings is, how much energy and GHG emissions it is contributing, what are the services and what are the equipments. And we came across that heating, ventilation, air conditioning system, HVAC and lighting, we have figured are the two major equipment and needs to be controlled. There are the other equipments, other pluggable loads, other services that can also be focused upon. But in my research, I have taken into consideration the HVAC and the lighting system. You take into account certain assumptions that I have taken into account a single for what we will see in the coming slides, that there are a single building thermal model, a single dimensional model. Now, development of building energy models are of two types or three types. One is white box modeling, second is black box modeling, and third is gray box modeling. See, any energy system model, mathematical model, is developed using some mathematical equation which governs the behavior of that system. You take some input variables, you clump that input, categorize those input variables as controllable and uncontrollable, and you give it to the energy system and you see the response or the output of it. White box model means that you know each and everything, each and every part, subpart, sub-subpart of the system that you are developing. Each and every transfer equation is there, and you use the detailed techniques, mathematical, analytical tools to solve the models and get the output. Black box models are what we do, the undergraduate, postgraduate students do in their laboratories doing the experiments. They don't know about the system. They know about only that there is a box. You give certain amount of inputs. You do certain experiments. You change the value of inputs. Develop table for outputs for that value of inputs. Use regression or other data analysis and get the equations of the model. That model is called as black box model, and hence the name black. That means you are not able to see anything about the system. Whereas white box model is the system is transparent. You are able to see each and everything in the model. Gray box models, exactly as you have suggested it correctly, it's a combination of white box modeling and black box modeling. There are certain aspects, certain parameters which you develop, which you estimate using the fundamental equations, and the other equations you require certain regression analysis. White box models are the most accurate, but as the order of the model which you would have studied in the control system aspect of your subject in your undergraduate EEE electrical and electronics people, it increases the order of the model, hence the computational demand is more. Black box model is less accurate, but the computational demand is less. Gray box model combines the individual merits of white box models and black box. It's not that we don't have the simulation programs. We have simulation programs. The softwares are available, which are certain open source and certain commercial building and simulation software. Now, selecting a building energy simulation program or a software depends majorly on the functionality of the building energy study. If the software you are using to design a building, that building is a residential building, is it a single zonal, is it a multi-zonal, is it a commercial complex, it is a municipal building, or a library, or a gym, so on. Also, how many number of times you have to use, that is the precision of the model, how much experience the modeler is. For example, I may have experience with certain amount of software, the other, and the same knowledge I want to replicate in other simulation software, and how experienced I am. And what is the hardware? What are the controlling techniques? See, I want to connect it to the Raspberry Pi board or Arduino board, or I want to connect it to the Internet of IoT of things, and what I want. There are very famous energy simulation programs, Energy Plus, Equest, ESPR, Transys, and we can use other mathematical simulation softwares as well if we want to develop white box models such as Python, such as MATLAB, so on and so forth. Now, after knowing that, okay, I will go for white box or black box or gray box model and what software I will be using, it is now imperative to categorize what parameters would be controllable or uncontrolled. Now, the parameters, significant parameters which I have used in my research are these parameters. And the nature have been given here. Now, there are certain limitations here. Solar radiation I have taken as an uncontrollable parameter for both residential and non-residential building. But this is not practically true, right? If I have a window and if I can use shades, then I can control the solar radiation creeping in, coming inside my model, right? So this is one limitation of my research that I will be showing off right now. But again, this again becomes a futuristic aspect and a potential of it. So this is one of the assumption. Thermophysical properties of the construction element means just look around the room which you are sitting in and watching this webinar. Just look around your room. It becomes like a cuboid where you have different walls and of different materials, same material, sorry, but consisting of different elements, such as you will have a wall, you will have a consist of, that wall would consist of a brick and then a mortar, and then there's insulation layer, paint. So it's a multi-layer concept. So each and every layer will have a different thickness, will have different thermal conductivity, will have different heat capacity, so on, and different density. And all these properties becomes the thermophysical properties of the construction. Now, what I have done is I have used electrical networks, resistance capacitance networks, simple networks, which you must have studied in your network theory of your first year or second year course. What I have done is I have taken temperature to be in analogous as voltage and heat flow rate to be analogous as current. Why? Because by natural law, it states that the heat flows from a higher temperature region to a lower temperature, similar to the electric current which flows from a higher potential point to a lower potential point. And this is the law that I have used to develop the thermal electrical analogy and hence the network. It's not that the models are not available. Literature gives us the models, but there are certain aspects in which certain gaps that I have identified. One of the major gaps has been in the structure and accuracy. One of the major gap has been in the parameter selection and the influence of it. What happens is, because of the gap between the mechanical, electrical, civil, and architectural part, if we are developing an electrical control system, the models which we have used are single order models because they are very easy to model and they get very fast response. But it loses accuracy. Parameter selection, what we have done is the values of R's and C's, resistances and capacitances, have been equally uniformly divided depending upon the total thermal resistance and the total thermal capacity. Looked into the modeling performance. What are the performance characteristics? We have looked into the modeling performance characteristics. We have developed stability analysis, controllability analysis, observability analysis. We have developed the optimization techniques where we have used the genetic algorithm and also the PSO, and we have developed a multi-objective optimization. What a building layer, multi-layered building energy model I have developed as a second order model. As you can see, there will be, if you will develop the ordinary differential equations, this is something which you would have studied in your third semester numerical methods undergraduate students. It's pretty easy. What we have done is we have used for one building wall, one wall, it's only one wall, one construction element. We have modeled as a 3R, three resistance and two capacitance modeling. And the values of these resistances are fractions of the total thermal resistance and total thermal capacitance. Total thermal resistance is nothing but depending upon the physical property of the building construction element which has been. Similarly, total thermal capacitance depends upon the thickness, density, and the specific capacity, thermal capacity of the particular layer. As I said, layers can be the thermal insulation, brick, there are certain air gaps, and also the thermal paint or insulation. Right? Now, what I have done is I know the value of RTH, which I can get from here, because if I'm going, the architect will give me all these values. So I know RTH value, I know CTH value, I just want to know the X's and the Y's. Now, as I have already outlined in the gap, it's easy that I make this as 1 by 3, 1 by 3, 1 by 3, and Y's as 1 by 2, 1 by 2. But this does not replicate the complete behavior of that construction. So what we have done is, we have developed an optimization algorithm that would give us the fraction these X's and the fraction these Y's. Now, having developed a building wall model, And the same approach to be used for the other walls of the buildings, depending upon how they are exposed to the outdoor environment, it is imperative that we develop a model for a heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system. The model that I have worked on is a heat exchanger third order lump circuit model and a control wall model. And the control is being controlled by the signal given from a PID controller. See, the PID controllers are traditionally used and still now they are being put in use. The only thing is how you are tuning the values of KP, KI, and TD is depending upon the artificial intelligence techniques or the techniques that are being used nowadays. I have used the traditional method. And the output that I am getting out is the, as you can see, the HVAC system will be what will be the building space, ventilation and infiltration air change rate. This is nothing but a mathematical expression, which will give me how much cooling with a good ventilation can be provided out of a HVAC system. So what I have done is we didn't do any experimental hardware analysis, but I have taken an ASHRAE, American Society Heating, Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers Handbook. I have taken a test case. These are the parameters that I have taken. They have test walls. And this is the parameter that I have taken for the HVAC system and developed my model. Now for a white box model, I have used finite difference formulation for a single dimensional Newton's law of cooling heat conduction equation. I have used Crank-Nicholson method, which uses the central difference scheme to solve this model order. Now, when I say solving, that means getting this curve. This is the temperature rise curve. Oh, sorry, temperature curve. As you can see that the outdoor, what you can see here is the outdoor is at a larger temperature, building space is at lower temperature. Do note that here the temperature is not being controlled by any HVAC system, right? This is a white box model. This is a larger order model and requires a larger computational demand. This model is reduced to a second order model. And as you all know, that a second order 3R2C model is being widely used because we know we can get the performance characteristic in terms of peak time, settling time, rise time, maximum overshoot, and the steady state error. That means we can give a step input, impulse input, ramp input, depending sinusoidal input, depending upon what you want to model and get the outputs. And that's why I have chosen the second order model. How much time do I have left?
Sir, you have more 23 minutes.
How many minutes?
23 minutes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Now, the optimization algorithm which we have modeled takes into account the error function. What I will do is I will give an input here. I don't know the value, so I will start with the guess value of x1, x2, x3 and a guess value of y1 and y2 and get the values of r1, r2, r3, c1, c2 from these expressions. And then the same input will be given to this model. The output will be recorded. Here the output will be recorded. The outputs of both the models, the square root of the sum squared error of both the outputs will be taken and will be reduced by taking into account an optimization algorithm. Now that optimization algorithm has fetched us for my building model all the values of R and all the values of C. Actually, it has fetched X1, X2, X3 and Y1, Y2. Multiplying that for a particular RTH that I have taken from the ASHRAE handbook of fundamentals, we get the values of R's and C's. Now this algorithm I have done for one wall, mind you, this is for one wall. So one second order model is for one wall. And as I request you again to look around, you know that you are sitting inside a cuboid like this with a couple of windows and a solar radiation. And that means that we have a 3R2C model. 3R2C model is this model. A 3R2C model for a roof, for an external wall, for a lobby, for a floor, for two adjacent walls. And a window I have taken as a purely resistance and a one single capacitance model, because a large amount of solar radiation because of the glass effect comes inside. And an internal mass, that means you may have computers inside, you may have certain occupant based equipment which would contribute to the thermal mass inside your building, and a capacitance of the air. So this would give us the temperature of the building space inside the room that we are sitting, right? Now, having developed the model, I have run the model for 1 month, for one summer season, for one winter season, and also for 1 year. And I have calculated the energy consumption for all these time parameters that I have outlined. Now it's time that we develop comfort occupation, comfort analysis. I've taken into account the thermal comfort, which is dependent upon the temperature, the indoor air visual comfort, which is depending upon the lux values, illumination level, and the indoor air quality, which depends upon the PPM concentration of the CO2. The formula that I have taken are from the empirical, as I told you, no experimental was carried out. These are the empirical analysis taken from the ASHRAE's book, and I have calculated the comfort of the occupants, overall comfort of the occupants inside a building space that I have modeled here. Similarly, I have calculated the energy consumption analysis. Now, the major point here is it becomes a multi-objective optimization. Why? Yes, you want to minimize the energy being consumed by the lighting system and by the HVAC, but without jeopardizing the comfort of the occupants. This is what a major scenario comes in. See, reduction of energy consumption, you can develop, you can use different techniques, you can get free out open source algorithms for MATLAB or Proteus. You can develop your own Arduino algorithms, and you can say that you have developed a smart home energy system. But what about the people living inside that building? You have to take into due consideration the occupants' comfort as well, right? And that's what we have taken. If you would see, I have modeled the occupants' comfort inside the optimization algorithm as a discomfort model. So it becomes maximization of comfort, becomes minimization of discomfort, and minimization of energy. You could see that we will get a Pareto front solution. Pareto front solution because whenever you model a multi-objective optimization algorithm, there will never be a single solution. There will be sample solutions, which we will be getting it. So sample solutions for building space temperature, for building illumination level, and for building indoor air quality. And also for the occupants' comfort. This is 98.95%, 94%. And this is better also, right? For a sample solutions, you can provide it to the consumer, and the consumer itself will take into consideration, okay, now it's I want a comfort more, so my setting will be this setting. No, I don't much have more of a comfort, so my setting would be this setting. That means, as we have regulator for fans, can we have a regulator for a controller that would control the thermostat setting, the illumination index, and also the CO2 concentration. Now, one of the major, we can see that the discussion for that I have done, showing you the results that I have done for 1 day analysis. As you can see here, this is the thermostat setting that has been set. Without control, you can see without control is PID control, which you can see that the variations are very large. Whereas from our intelligent control, smart intelligent multi-objective control, the variation is less. Same goes for the CO2 concentration. Same goes for the illumination level and the occupants comfort. Now, there is one major limitation or drawback here of mine. The limitation is the thermostat set point temperature, I have put it as a constant value throughout the day, but it is not true, right? In the afternoon, the thermostat setting would be different. In the night, it would be different. Or in the late night, it would be different, right? Similarly, here, the illumination index I have taken as constant. But if your room is big, if your room volumetric space of your room is large, these parameters cannot be constant, but would vary depending upon the specific location of your building. So this becomes one of the research area where I am looking for good students to work on, right? Now, same thing I have done for the saving analysis with control, without control. As you can see, as the time frame increases, the percentage saving is also increasing, right? For only, if you do for only daily, you are getting very low energy saving percent. So this means that this is a controller and the payback period would be a little more than a day, that you would not get a profit only within a day or for a short period of time, right? Having modeled a building energy control system, what I have started off with the previous slide, that there are four major steps. One of the steps was, how would you take this model and interact with the electrical power grid? What we will do is we will take into account the swing equation, which you will study in your power system analysis, maybe in your fifth sem or sixth sem of your undergraduate study, and also the first year of your postgraduate study. You will take into consideration the swing equation. Now, what we can do here is, we have developed a cluster of the building models. This will be for one building, then there will be a cluster of buildings. You can develop a building model. You will get certain loading aspect, electricity aspect, for every building, for every hour. For every building, for every hour. That you will put here in the swing equation, and see what are the dynamics of the electrical power grid, which is happening. And this is a very famous swing equation, which you already know, right? And that's why how you can develop a grid interactive building energy system. Now, let us look into the aspect of, I just came to know from one of the moderators that yesterday the IEEE Shreyas section had a very good lecture on blockchain, which gave us the peer-to-peer communication aspect. I would not say that blockchain is an ideal technology to be used right now, but yes, the concept of peer-to-peer energy sharing and trading can be looked upon. Now, we have certain amount of buildings which have solar PV panels installed, and there are certain amount of buildings which may not install the solar PV panels. And this happens usually for two reasons. One is a good solar profile is not coming. Maybe the building's orientation is such a way that for within a day, the number of hours that a sunshine comes is pretty low, or shading comes in, or the economics doesn't approve the building owner to have a building rooftop solar PV. But how you can make the consumer to participate, make the consumer to participate inside the green renewable energy aspect. If this electricity consumer can consume electricity from solar, electricity that is being generated from solar PV, we could regard them as a green energy consumer. And that's where a peer-to-peer model comes. The solid lines here give us the power flow, and the dotted line gives us the information flow, that all the information from the smart meters connected both the presumers. Presumer is a new term which is being used in the renewable energy market. That means it's a building which is both a producer of electricity through on-site energy generation, which is green, and also the consumer of electricity. Of course, the batteries are also there, and the consumer. And all this communication is going to the centralized peer-to-peer station, P2P station. The centralized P2P station will run some algorithms and will communicate back, yes, this much amount of energy is available and this much amount of energy is required at this period of time, and the costing aspect of it, because you also do the peer-to-peer trading. So what every household will have? A presumer, Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, sir, we are able to
yeah,
hear
I
you.
am extremely sorry. I have my system got rebooted. I am extremely sorry. So without wasting time, I'll continue. So what I am trying to show in this slide here is what will be there, what are the systems will be there inside a prosumer. We have a rooftop solar PV, of course. There will be certain loads that I have taken, battery storage, a meter and a breaker, and will be connecting to the micro. Similarly, a consumer will have each and everything, but without the panel. Now, two things. One, why is there a battery for a consumer? Yes, without battery also, you can have a consumer in this model. But why we have modeled with a battery is because we are also looking inside the P2P trading aspect. Now, the electricity for maybe in the midnight or in some in winter's afternoon, the electricity demand would be very less. So the consumer would want to buy that electricity, get its battery charged, so that in the time coming where the demand will be more, the consumer wants to sell that electricity at a certain tariff, of course, being generated by, again, the centralized P2P station by using this battery. If there would have been no battery, the consumer will only be buying electricity, cannot sell electricity. With battery storage, because there is no rooftop solar PV, with battery storage, the consumer can also participate in selling of the electricity. So what I'm trying to make here is a sustainable business model. Of course, what I've done is only simulation analysis. The experimental analysis still need to be done. Now, the household loads that I have taken are the services that I have bifurcated for rural households. These are lighting and entertainment purposes, the applications, heating and cooling. This has come from my own research, being interviewing so many people for so many for a couple of years, that entertainment becomes one of the major aspect, primary aspect for households. Yes, they would say that at the night they would not require lighting, but sir, charging ke liye hume mobile chahiye, because we would want watch movies, we would want to watch YouTube videos, we want to develop, if I could say, some TikTok or some YouTube videos, and yes, they require entertainment. So that means I have to give them USB-based charging port for their mobiles, right? And that's why this has been taken. Now, what lies in the future? What I'm looking into the future? Consumer willingness. What I'm looking is how much. See, the peer-to-peer energy trading model, which one can develop, the consumer should be given the liberty that when the consumer wants to come out of the system and get into the system. Maybe I don't want to participate in peer-to-peer sharing. Maybe summer holidays, I'm going out for 2 months, for 1 month. Maybe I don't want to do it. So what mathematical indexes and artificial intelligence technique that I can use, make use of, where I can learn about the consumer willingness? What are the forecasting studies both for demand and both for renewable energy sources? What are the planning pricing strategy that I have to take into consideration? Should this system be owned by a centralized P2P station, or does the system be owned by the electrical utility, distribution utility, DISCOM, or should it be owned by the user? What it should be, and what should be the strategy of the planning? Can this become one microgrid and the other microgrids can participate in peer-to-peer, and how can it be? That is also one aspect that can be looked upon. Can my model fail? What I am saying right now, whom to validate, how can it be validation? And all these aspects lies in the aspect from the undergraduate project study up till the PhD postdoc research study is an aspect. So this is a figure that I have taken one of the book, that we can develop one building and have it a solar PV and also the ground source geothermal energy with thermal energy storage and the battery storage, smart equipment, smart systems, connecting all these through the grid with the use of plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. What I'm looking right now is to develop a simulation-based tool to evaluate both the technical aspect, the social aspect, that is the consumer willingness, economic aspect, business model of consumer-based energy systems, and to assess the energy and also the environmental aspects of buildings. So the energy institutions which all of you can look upon, which are working for this aspect of building energy systems and grid interactive building energy system, are our governmental ministries. If you go through the website, they will have a dedicated building energy efficiency option, which you can see. Apart from this, there are certain autonomous institutions which are trying to work on and developing the report, doing market studies, funding agencies, and there are certain institutions, research institutions like PDPU and other IITs, energy institutions, energy trading indexes, which are working on the algorithm, the trading aspect, and there are certain institutions which are MSMEs also, which are NGOs also, which are working on here. So in the Department of Electrical Engineering of PDPU, we have different research groups, renewable energy systems, power systems operation and control research group, power electronics and drives research group, where we make use of the simulation software like MIPower, MATLAB, ETAP, DSpace, LabVIEW, PSIM, PSCAD, and work towards renewable energy based, artificial intelligence based power systems. We have an MTech power systems program where we the PDPU provides stipend for both GATE scholars and also non-GATE scholars. The stipends are there. And we have a dedicated 1 year dissertation program, complete 1 year dissertation program, which we can, which the student can do in-house with a faculty and also with an industry. Yes, of course, when you do with an industry, you have institute guide as well. The other groups are control systems, smart energy systems, energy efficiency and conservation systems, where in smart energy systems, we are working on the machine learning and IoT enabled microgrid as well, and also the power electronic converters. And you can look, these are the details. I would pass on the slide to the moderators. They can communicate with you, those who have registered, and you can go into the site. I welcome you to go into the site and look into it. I have given the faculty contacts as well. The faculties are available. They are dedicated faculties. You mail them and they are ready to interact with any of you in any which area which you are interested in. I really want to thank the IEEE Shreyas section, IEEE Hyderabad section, Shreyas Institute of Engineering and Technology, all the viewers for all your patient learning. Thank you so much. Sorry for a small technical glitch, and sorry if I had taken more than 1 hour. Thank you very much.
Participants, if you have any doubts, please do post in the comment box so that the sir can answer.
Are there any questions?
Participants, if there are any questions, please do post down in the comment box so that sir can answer.
I think there is one question here.
Sir, please. Sir.
How are your model considered the climatical component? Yes, as I have shown you in the parameters part. There are components for sole air temperature, which is an aspect of an outdoor air temperature. I have taken a dry bulb temperature. I have also taken the wind characteristics, precipitation, and from the orientation of the building, I'll get what are the, how the mathematically the vectors are striking the building surface. That also I have taken. Viability of green buildings with limited money, which we have, yes, there is. I hope you are asking about the cost viability. Yes, there is a cost viability for a particular green building, and hence it has become an architectural aspect also from the last 100 years. If you would go to the Technological Development Board, TIFAC website of DST, you would see the use of fly ash bricks, bamboo stakes, or the local energy sources which can be made used of at for optimal usage to develop a building. So in itself, you take into account the green building aspect. So green building takes into consideration the local factors also, how much energy and water is being used, how much energy and water is being wasted, and if there is certain wastage, how you are reusing that amount of. There are a lot of questions. Do we have time? Can I take more questions?
Yes, sir. We have buffer time for about 15 minutes.
Okay. Can we use artificial intelligence in modeling the climatic section? Yes. Modeling the climate section, you can use the traditional models, but to make forecasting series, you can use artificial intelligence technique. What usually is being done is, it depends upon the you develop probability functions where you have Gaussian models, Gaussian mixture models, and you develop distribution functions, and then you use forecasting techniques to forecast how my bell curve would behave or how my curve would behave. What kind of challenges does this model face to bring this into actual application on a large scale? First thing is the reliability study. Second thing is the model order reduction. I have not done the experimental analysis to know how much amount of information I am losing. I don't know what will happen if my model will fail, if the controller will fail. Would the AC be completely switched off? Or would the thermostat setting, if set at 24 or 26, would remain and we have to reboot the system? Such are the things that can be very interesting to look upon. What is the validation for a green building certification? It depends upon what you are being used. For example, if you have been Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So a green building certification, for example, if you are a particular green auditor or AP member, that certification can be from 2 years, so on and so forth. And for a particular building, there are four levels of certification. There are different levels of certification. For example, if you take LEED, there are four levels of certification. One is certified up to 40, 49 points. Minimum 40 points should be there. Up to 49 points certified, up to 59 points silver, up to 79 points gold, and more than 80 points is platinum. For practical purposes, can black box be trusted? Yes, black box have been trusted, but it depends upon where you want to use that model aspect. For example, for laboratory scale purposes or for single zonal models, you can use black box models. There is no problem in using it. It gives a very good advantage of using less computational demand. But if you want to replicate those models and extend those models taking into different parameters also, it's better to use a combination of white box and black box, because we already have good computational, we are getting good computers, high speed computers at a good cost, at an optimal cost. Sir, can you could suggest some methods about how to contribute for grid modernization? In terms of buildings, we have to make buildings responsive. Like what we do, we know that why we use capacitors or capacitor banks or reactors for regulating the reactive power flow. Why do we use synchronous condensers, so on and so forth. So can we take into account a building? Because with the time in the future and the amount, the thought that I seed in, that with a large amount of people working from home, there will be a smart home aspect and electric vehicles coming into the future in the picture. How each and everything can be clumped, make a one node and can contribute for the real power and reactive power to the grid? What are the converters which are required? What are the grid stabilization techniques which are required? What are the voltage regulation techniques which are required? And what are the safety precautions which are required? If there is so much of dynamics happening, you would not want the grid to go out of synchronism. So what are the protection techniques which are required? What are the relaying techniques which are required? It can be worked upon. What is the future work possible in this particular project? Which I have given the future scope, that can a simulation tool and app based, can I have a mobile app, can I develop a Excel based or Visual Basic based or a software based, MATLAB based GUI interface, where I can take into account all these parameters and communicate it to the consumer, leave it to the consumer, and the consumer itself will act to behave if they want to use energy optimally or if they want more comfort, and what are the cost dynamics? I think there are more questions which are around repetitive with these only. So I think there are more questions coming. How model in climatic has been used? Yes. What are the weather parameters? Yes. Okay. I think I can stop here now.
Yes, sir.
Actually, I have a meeting again at 12:30.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. We would like to give a special thanks to Harish sir for giving us your valuable time and for sharing the knowledge with our students and the professors from other states too. Thank you once again, sir. I'd also like to extend my thanks to our respected HODs, respected principal and management for being with us throughout, and also IEEE for giving us an opportunity to be a part in sharing knowledge to students and the fellow members. I hope this seminar was extremely useful and all the participants also gained knowledge and a new learning experience. Thank you all for your participation. Hope the same continues. And we are very happy to announce that we have got participations from the Denmark, Ethiopia, Maldives and Kolhapur. So like international participations are also coming for IEEE Shreya student branch. We are happy for this smaller milestone. And before we all could leave, I request all the participants to make sure that you drop down your mail IDs in the chat box. Thank you.
Thank you.